I've been working really hard over the last few weeks on this little tiny RISC-V emulator. The really tiny part about it is it doesn't have an MMU, which is something that virtually all desktop modern processors have. And the reason I wanted to do this was because I wanted to see if I could run Linux on it, something that was close to, but not quite as simple as a ESP32C3. And, well, the answer was yes. In fact, I was able to write a really tiny RISC-V emulator. It's the actual emulator part all exists in this one function in this header file, and is only around 350, 400 lines of code. And it's able to run Linux, and I'm able to be able to like have executables and whatever on it. Like I could run duct tape test and fizzbuzz.js, and you can see that it's able to run these applications in Linux. Now, the big part of this was that nobody would ever expect to be able to run Linux without an MMU, a memory management unit. But there's been a lot of efforts by people like Reggie MM and the folks who are working on the K210 Linux efforts to be able to make it so that you can actually run Linux on these really primitive processors. My primary inspiration for this project was by Pi. Pi wrote this pixel shader, which actually emulated a full RISC-V RV32 IMU CPU. Now, this had everything. This had the whole memory management unit, it had SU, it had all of the ZICRs, and it ran Linux, full-fledged Linux, inside of the pixel shader, which was wild because inside of the world that this computer ran in, there was just a texture on the wall, which was literally the system memory of the system that was booting Linux when you loaded into the world, which, I don't know, that was just crazy. Now, I wanted to see if I could make it a little bit faster, but mostly, I just kind of wanted to explore this just for fun.
I've been throwing around a lot of acronyms, but that's because RISC-V isn't just one basic architecture. It's a very flexible architecture, able to be 32, 64, or 128-bit, and it has a myriad of different configurations of the core processor and different components that can be placed around it. Everything from processors that don't have integer multiply and divide features to ones which have all sorts of crazy features, like quad precision floating point extensions. While you can build the whole system from scratch, I included a build step that does all of the hard work that you're about to hear about called make test DL image that downloads a pre-built system image and compiles the emulator and runs it so that you can get up and running in under 2 seconds. Or if you're on Windows and you don't want to install the Windows subsystem for Linux, you can easily download TinyCC with a PowerShell script or an installer, and I have a PowerShell script that downloads the image, compiles the emulator with TCC and runs it. Neat thing is, the resulting EXE in Windows is only about 16 kilobytes and has no dependencies. The emulator itself has platform-specific code to handle things like the Windows terminal being put into VT100 mode that Linux expects, handling keyboard and timers. Going deeper, though, I'd like to tell the story of how I did this project. I barely knew RISC-V, and I had no idea about any of the more advanced features in it, or if it was even possible to build an RV32 no-MMU Linux image.
So the first thing I did was Google it, and I came across this tweet from August. So I reached out, and RegMM started helping me. What this actually was just a build root configuration, basically, and a set of patches. So I was able to take those patches and put it into my project. Now, build root is this makefile sort of thing, but it's enough of a makefile to be able to build an entire Linux system. If you're going to work on this project, one of the first things that you're probably going to want to do is clone this project and say make everything. Make everything is actually going to go get a copy of build root and use the configuration, both that RegMM and I put together, for the kernel and for build root to be able to build a system. Now, build root is really cool because it builds everything. It builds a compiler, and it builds the compiler that's going to use that compiler. That's going to be your host compiler. Now, your host compiler is also going to build the compiler, which is going to compile the OS on your target device, which is just a lot of fun, because as you can watch this text streaming by, it really feels like you're gaining a couple IQ every single time. Now, this is not just compiling the base system. It's compiling things like BusyBox. And BusyBox contains all of the important functionality that you would need to be able to do on your system. Things like ls and deleting and moving files and things like that. But it's also compiling the kernel, which is the core OS. And on top of all of that, it even can compile things like QEMU. Now, the nice thing about that was it was able to get me to a point where I could verify that the version of what I was working on actually did work, which was great because it is so much easier to start from a known working condition of things and kind of work backwards. Now, I do want to spend at least a quick moment complaining about that, because for some reason QEMU uses something in their toolchain which uses Python to get built, which then also requires Ninja, which requires CMake. Now, the annoying thing is buildroot would just be done if it weren't for needing CMake. CMake is one of the longest legs to compile in all of this, and then Python right behind, and then QEMU last. So, Now, it's really important that you start with something that works, because you want the thing that you're testing to actually work so that when you're writing your own emulator, when you're met with this black screen of doom with nothing coming out the other side, you can start to try to figure out what's going on. There's really two pieces I had to go on. One was that I'd be able to make my kernel, I could say, test with QEMU, and I would be able to run it on QEMU and verify that whatever I was trying to test actually did work. The other one was I could go and I could look at the code that PyMaker wrote for their system, and I'd be able to go check and see how they were able to get it working.
I've also included a bare metal project, and what this does is it runs without any OS or bootloader or anything else, so that you can go write C or assembly code and see how it all gets linked together into one tiny flat binary file. This includes examples of how to write inline assembly and how to write GNU assembly right there that can be linked together with your C code. It's kind of an educational tool for the most part, but it was really helpful when I was first getting the processor off the ground, just to be able to step through everything individually and make sure that the processor was behaving itself. One of the things I wanted to touch on was makefiles. Makefiles are a really powerful tool that are actually a lot simpler than you would expect. All they are is just a set of rules for how to make things. So to the left of the colon, you have the thing, and on the right, you have all the things that that thing depends on. And then underneath of it, you just have all of the commands that you need to run in order to get that thing. And this is really great for chaining together whatever kind of complicated tasks you would want to do. You can just tell make exactly how you want to go build whatever it is you want to build. It doesn't have to be complicated.
One of the things that I did a lot of was printf debugging, and I left some of that inside of the final copy here. So, with -s being passed into the flags, you can then see what the processor is doing at every single time step here. So it's starting at address 80000, moving up to 5C, 6064, and so on, and I can go catch it when it's in some sort of like weird failure mode. You might wonder, that's great, but what do those crazy numbers mean? Well, what I can do is I can say make dump kern, and this is using one of the tricks I talked about in my talk, where you can use objdump-s to go dump the raw binary of the thing into a sort of easier-to-read assembly file. And that's what this is right here. And so what I can see on the far left is the address that each one of these instructions is located at, and the assembly instructions associated with that command. And because there's debugging symbols included with the kernel, I can also get just the functions that everything is located within. So, for instance, here, where I'm stuck kind of bouncing between B4, B8, B0, B4, B8, and so on, I can go see where is that. And I can do that by Control F and looking for it and seeing like, oh, it's actually inside of this section called Clear BSS, which, well, that's great because that's going to take a little while to go finish. But let's run it a little bit longer. So now we're in some sort of other strange location. Let's see where we are right now. I'm going to go take this address, paste it in here, and see what it's doing. And so I can see this is inside of this little save context thing. And I can go up and look around, and that would be inside of an interrupt. And I can go start searching these things out and trying to understand why is my processor not working. Now, the one thing that's really depressing is I did find out what it was, but it took over probably 7 or 8 hours for me to find out that in this case, one of my most frustrating bugs that I had was that I had to go flip the direction of the sign there. So if I were to do that, and I say test kern, Now, all of a sudden, everything did work. Now, of course, in reality, it wasn't everything just worked, but I would do one step at a time, and you can just imagine the party I had when I was finally able to see it print out Linux version 5.18.0. For now, though, let's go change this back, and I want to show you another technique that I use to debug this. Inside of here is the entry code for the kernel, and conveniently, everything goes through the one handler. So it's very, very basic, and I can go insert assembly code into here to do whatever I'd like. Now, one of the interesting parts about being able to write your own emulator is you can go do whatever you want. So for instance, if I go write to a CSR, I can go execute a printf right there, so I can printf debug my code from inside the kernel outside the kernel. Now, some of the things I had before was just 138 would go print a string from wherever the pointer was. Is this safe? Absolutely not, because it means that something inside of the emulator could go run code outside the emulator. Was it fun? Oh boy, was it. So, for instance, here, let's go add something just to be able to see what some of the registers are or something like that. If, say, for instance, here, I wanted to go investigate what is the value of SP,
I could say CSRW or CSRWrite 0x137,
comma, SP. Now, I might have that code wrong, but we'll see. Now, inside of the main thing, I can just say make toolchain again. And it's going to go copy the configs over, and it's going to go build buildroot. Buildroot is then going to go recompile the kernel and get it ready for output. And from there, I can say make testkern, and I can see that it is printing a whole lot of 8000 1BCs. So I can now know that that's what that value is right there in assembly. So that whole process was pretty quick, just because from here you can go investigate all of these different things and be able to pause the code effectively, or even have it so that the code would exit in a certain situation if a certain value is a certain thing. And that's just one of the techniques that I used when I was exploring all of this. If I wanted to say investigate X1, I could do that, and you can see this again. I can say make toolchain, and toolchain goes, pulls all the configs, then starts compiling, recompiles the kernel, has it ready for use, and there we go. All of that was in real time. So I was recompiling the whole kernel and rebuilding the system image in order to do that. Now, one of the interesting parts that I'd like to dig into right now is exactly how the system image works. The system image is part of buildroot, and inside of buildroot you have this output folder. In an output folder you have images, and here we have a bunch of different things. We have a rootfs, which is sort of a tar version of our target right here. And target can be whatever you want to put in here. Now, mind you, this is not a root file system because you can't run it from here, but you can put files that you want to end up in there. Now, what happens is the tar is made, the tar is turned into a CPIO, the Linux kernel has to be compiled once just to get that going, but then the CPIO can be embedded in the image. And so this image here is literally RISC-V code from the start, and it contains the entire root file system. So if I say hex dump dash c image, you can actually see that this code here contains just the raw binary blob, and it can just start executing. In fact, this first thing right here is a jump, which takes me to another interesting point. That interesting point is this tool here, this rvcodec.js. Now, it's a little bit annoying because they represent the bytes backwards for me, but we can just reorder the bytes inside of here, and we can go see what this command is. So I can look at the very first line of the kernel here, the very first 4 bytes, rather, of the kernel image, and we can see that it's a jump and link x0, 92. So it means it jumps forward 92 instructions, and it starts executing from there. 92 is 5C hex, so if we go to 5C right here, we can go see what the next instruction that the kernel executes is. And that next instruction is CSRRW X0MIE X0. I don't off the top of my head know what that is. I think what it's doing is it's making it so no interrupts can fire, which is a pretty grand thing to do as your first operation. Let's go see how that compares to what the emulator says is going on. So if I go now, instead of running it with that, let's go and undo the change that we just made. And rebuild. Okay, and now what we're going to do is we're going to step through each instruction at a time. And let's see, we're going to 80, and then we jump to 5C, and then the next instruction is 60. So you can see that this image that's being produced by BuildRoot is literally just a binary executable blob, and that's what represents the kernel. Let's go get this done with and fix the code again so it actually runs. Once I was able to get my code working once, I was able to then enter a mode of something called test-driven development. Now, normally people would start with really small tests and get bigger from there. This was a little bit weird because really what I was trying to find out was what is the bare minimum that you can get away with and run the kernel. So I kind of did this backwards to get to the kernel. Once I had something that mostly ran, a system that was up and running, I was able to go then and convert the code. This code here is really rough, like very, very poorly written, lots of just junk everywhere, and I was able to start changing things and start cleaning things up to the more modern code that I have right here. And the nice part was, because of test-driven development, I had a really good test. I could go run the Linux kernel and run applications inside of the Linux kernel. So I could incrementally make very small changes, like you noticed that one right there, and see if the kernel still works. And I was able to really shave off a lot of the size and complexity from my emulator over time just by being able to go edit it and be able to go test the emulator and see that it still worked because I was running it with Linux. Normally when doing a project like this, you would want to use these RISC-V tests. These are very, very granular tests, the best way to do it. But unfortunately, the RISC-V tests here were particularly difficult to get going in my infrastructure, and they test huge portions of the processor, which Linux doesn't use, and I really don't want to implement those portions of the processor. While there's a lot more to do just to make this thing better and faster and everything else, there are some directions I would like to head with this. I would like to see if I can find a way to make Linux boot without the RV32A extension. For instance, if you don't have multiple processors, I think you should be able to get Linux to run without the RV32A extension. I also want to be able to see if we can support relocatable ELFs, and there has been a lot of work done recently to make that possible on non-MMU systems. Additionally, one of the really annoying parts that I find is that when I run it, It runs really fast at boot, so like everything prints out immediately, but when the final like UART driver gets loaded, it makes it go really slow. And it's because the UART driver that actually gets loaded for the real system is more complicated and, well, I don't really get it. It looks like it's like waiting on the baud rate basically versus early con. If you watch, it just boots up instantly. Everything just appears. So it'd be really cool if I could figure out a way to make the boot console be the thing that actually runs. You can see here it's disabling the boot console. And I have tried running it with keep boot con, but that doesn't seem to work for some reason. I do hope to be able to run this in a pixel shader. It'd be great if I could get OpenSBI working on this, because then I'd be able to just write some of the drivers in OpenSBI instead. This was the route that Pi went, and that was a really good way to do it, but I have not been able to get OpenSBI working on this yet. Additionally, I think it would be really fun to be able to embed this RV32 emulator in other random projects. It's like a scripting language, except a scripting language you can compile to with GCC. There are other questions, like also, can I allocate more memory contiguously? Anyway, this has been a really fun project, and I might keep going with it. I might drop it on the floor. I'm not really sure. I've really been kind of surprised by just how fast it is, how great everything around it has worked.
I want to give a huge shout out to RegiMM for helping with a lot of this and their project, this quasi-SOC, which is intended to be something that could potentially someday be like a desktop system.
If you're interested in this, you can check out Mini RV32 IMA. Project link is in the description, and thanks for watching.